Fischer, the mayor of Louisville. Thank you for joining us on this Facebook town hall featuring Dr. Marty Pollio, the superintendent of Jefferson County Public Schools. And today's topic is going to be about lifelong learning and all the activity that JCPS has had over this past month as we've entered this pandemic phase in our country and how that's impacted JCPS and the learning of all of our students here in the city. So just huge amount of activity has taken place and disruption to our lives and livelihoods. And also that has really taken place in the classroom as well. So we'll be talking about that today. I invite people that are watching to go to your chat function and send questions our way. And we'll be happy to discuss those here throughout the next 45 minutes or so. We'll be getting off around 10:45 today. So obviously we've always relied on education to create opportunities, to be the great equalizer for us in this country. And different people access education different ways. And that's the same with JCPS. Some of our students, some come with all the advantages in the world. Some come with not so many. So there's just a huge challenge in delivering education when you've got a school system the size of Jefferson County Public Schools with over 100,000 kids in it right now. So you throw a pandemic on top of that, and all of a sudden we've got some real challenges to deal with in terms of how do we make sure that our kids continue to receive an education while school is in session. So I want to thank Dr. Pollio and his team at JCPS. They have been hyper-focused on this. The passion that they have for delivering education to our students has always been unequaled, because if you're in the business of educating kids, you take that on full knowing all of the challenges that come with it. So it takes special people, I think, to really be the educators in our community. So I want to thank Dr. Pollio and his team. And I want to thank them for making sure that our public school students have access to online learning at this point in time in our city and our country's history, because not every city has taken the steps to make sure that that has taken place. So when you think about the logistics of this, there's still of 100,000 students, there's still tens of thousands in the low tens that don't have access to the internet and then don't have a hardware device to get on and do their homework and do their learning at the same time. So this presents some real challenges to start off with in terms of our city value around equity, and that is making sure everybody has access, in this case, access to learning and the materials to learn. So JCPS has been through a real logistical challenge to get all the Chromebooks that they've had in their classrooms out into the families. Dr. Pollio will talk about that. And they're doing that in the context of providing food for JCPS students with meal services throughout the day as well. So needless to say, JCPS has been very busy while they're in this non-traditional mode. So I want to say thank you to JCPS for doing that. We've also been grateful for our telecommunications providers who have stepped up and helped make internet, Wi-Fi more available inside the homes in our communities. Obviously, if you don't have internet capability in your home, it puts you at a disadvantage in terms of learning, research, applying for jobs. So that's been another aspect of this challenge as well. So we'll talk about all of that here today as we introduce Dr. Pollio. Dr. Pollio, welcome. Thank you for joining us. Two years ago, you raised your hand and said JCPS needs a interim superintendent. You were a guy that was just turning high schools around with a great background as a teacher, general manager of the Indiana University basketball team. Bobby Knight is the coach there. Now, all of a sudden, you find yourself leading one of the nation's largest public school systems, doing a heck of a job, in my estimation. And then this pandemic, COVID-19, is thrown at us, our community. Now you're saying, how does that impact our schools? So let's step back for a moment and say, what started going through all of your mind as this started coming into the community and your approach going there? So thank you for joining us, and I'll turn it over to you for a few comments.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor Fischer. We appreciate your support. It's been fantastic, and our partnership with the city to support our kids, even well before this, but even into this crisis, has been fantastic and really helps us as we move forward. And I don't think there's a better partnership between a city and a school system in America. And I talk to a lot of superintendents out there, so we're very thankful for that. You know, I flash back to about 7 weeks ago, when, you know, maybe 8 weeks ago, when we first started the pandemic was here in the United States, and it seemed to be spreading, especially on the West Coast. And I remember gathering the team together and saying, boy, you know, I think we really need to update our emergency plan around pandemics, because this is something that, you know, maybe in late April, May might hit here. And so we got together, we updated it as a health issue for us and the safety and security of our students and staff. At that time, we had no anticipation at all that we would be canceling school time or the rest of the year. And so as this developed very quickly, and I know spread across the country very quickly, we had to mobilize. At first, NTI was an option that I was not in support of, because we were in.
What's NTI?
Non-traditional instruction. So thank you. In education, we use those terms a lot. But non-traditional instruction, and really non-traditional instruction statewide, is for rural districts that have a lot of inclement weather days. And it was meant for school districts that they might have a couple of days of inclement weather and then kids would come back to school. It was never meant for 6, 8, 12 weeks of instruction. But as this developed, this pandemic developed, we knew that we could not have our kids sitting out of school potentially from March 15th to August 15th without some supports. There is no doubt that face-to-face instruction is much better, and this will not replace that. And we are going to have to take, and I'm sure we'll talk about significant issues on the back end to support kids in their growth. But what we decided to do was to take a couple weeks where we could build something special, not rush into it and just say, let's on Monday morning, all kids get on your computer, like some districts can do, interact with your teacher on Google Classroom and continue to work. We knew so many kids wouldn't have that opportunity, and we would leave so many kids behind. So we spent 2 weeks plus spring break building a platform with a great team here at JCPS. And I believe that intentionality made the difference in supporting our students. We still got a long way to go. And improvements to make, but really being intentional about equity and supporting all of our kids has really made a difference in the rollout of this non-traditional instruction.
So how's the rollout of the Chromebooks gone, and what kind of feedback are you getting from the families?
Yeah, so I mean, that was no small feat. I think sometimes it was underestimated how we have to do that. And as we know, and I'm sure you know, in metro government, a big challenge is trying to do this work without gathering people together because of social distancing. And so whether we're meeting like this virtually, or we have to physically, you know, we had all these Chromebooks in our schools. And so, you know, we had a choice to make. We could have them sit in the school and collect dust, or we could go get those Chromebooks and get them out to kids. But we still had to get into schools to get them. We had to have people disinfect them so that we knew they were safe for families. We had to box them up and send them out. We had to take phone calls in order to know which kids needed it. And so we had to do all of this while still social distancing like everybody, like we need to do. And so, you know, we can't underscore enough that challenge, but we opened it up and gave about 4 or 5 days for people to call in or to click on a link on their email or text messages to reserve a Chromebook. I believe our final number now has gone above 20,000 Chromebooks that we have sent out to families. So that's really about 1 in 5 students in JCPS have been sent a Chromebook to their house by mail so that they can use it. And we know, pleasantly surprised by the number of logins to Google Classrooms and the platforms that are supporting kids. And so just on day two of NTI alone, we had 80,000 logins into our Google Classroom. And so that's teacher and student, but a mean, that's a large number of kids that we know are getting access with a device and connectivity. And I think that's making a difference. So we're hoping that those 20,000 Chromebooks are making a difference in kids' lives.
And what percentage of your students do you estimate do not have access to the web?
So it's, you know, and I talk about this a lot, it's difficult to really pinpoint. So we have a comprehensive school survey every year where we say that really it shows about 90% of households have access to some type of internet or web access. But we also know a lot of those are phone services that might not be high speed, might not have the data, might not have the capability of interacting with the with a classroom teacher on things like Google Classroom, where kids can type assignments and then send them back to teachers. So yes, we know cell phone access is good, but actually sitting on a laptop, a Chromebook, an iPad, we know that we still probably have 30 to 40,000 kids who don't have that access. We just this week, we've begun the full paper packets at our feeding site. So if a student doesn't have access, they can come get packets. We gave out 35,000 of those within 2 or 3 days of folks at our feeding site. So we know there's still a large gap out there of this high speed internet access with a laptop, Chromebook, or iPad, one that they can do significant work with. And I think that's where we're going to improve out of this in the long run. And that's going to be our goal, is to bridge that divide of that digital, you know, that gap that we have. And so that we can do things differently down the road to support kids better.
Perfect. Okay, well, I'm Mayor Greg Fischer of Louisville, and this is joined by Dr. Marty Pollio, Superintendent of Jefferson County Public Schools. Feel free to send your questions our way. What's it like, Dr. Pollio, in the lunchrooms, breakfast rooms, or dining halls when we're coming and getting food, they're coming and getting papers? I mean, is it a quick moment of chaos? How do you do all that and manage that under the social distancing?
So we're really trying to do that outside of the buildings, obviously, so that people can pull up and get access to it. So when we started with our meals, we did it every day. And federal guidelines around nutrition services said that we can only provide one meal. So we could do breakfast and lunch for students for that day. Fortunately, we've been given the leeway to give multiple meals. And so instead of a family having to come every single day and interact, and our nutrition services workers being there. And so we're really working to practice social distancing and all the recommendations from you and from the governor to make sure we're doing things right and not putting our workers in danger. But first of all, I want to thank them. I mean, they are out there serving these meals to our students, and we truly appreciate them and the drivers that are getting the food there. So out of 17,000 employees, the vast majority, well into the high 90s, are working from home right now. But we know to give meals, they're going to have to be there. Fortunately, we went to a Monday, Wednesday, and Friday where we could pass out at these 69 sites. And on Monday and Wednesday, students can get breakfast and lunch for 2 days. So they can get 4 meals at a time and take that home with them. So that reduced the amount of interaction that we had right there. But I think it's just showing the need of our kids. We surpassed 400,000 meals yesterday that we've given to our students since the beginning of this. And right now, on Mondays and Wednesdays, we're giving over 40,000 meals at a time in 1 day. And so I believe before it's all said and done, I think it's pretty clear we'll probably surpass 1 million meals that we will pass out to the students of JCPS.
And that's a whole nother town hall for us to have on, you know, how can we have this much food insecurity in the richest country in the world? So we'll save that for another day. So talk a little bit about the first week of NTI. That was last week. And what were some of your biggest learnings and challenges?
Yeah, so we wanted to be very intentional, as I said. And so I know, you know, I'm on a lot of conference calls with a lot of other school districts across America, And really, we're a part of the Council of the Great City Schools, who actually had their national convention here in Louisville in the fall. But it's the top 76 superintendents in the United States of based on enrollment in districts, which JCPS is clearly one of those. And what we found, a lot of mistakes out there, as I said, was the rush to just implement this. We've got to get kids working right away and not being very intentional. Where the other side of it, there were a lot of districts who just said, we can't provide this type of instruction because we don't have the infrastructure for our students. And now they're backtracking on that, trying to figure out how to get there. And I think we navigated the right course, which was, let's take a couple of weeks and spring break and really build a platform that is second to none, supports for parents, for students, and for staff. We asked every single school, 159, to build a plan, and let's link it to one website. Let's put tutorials, videos for parents and teachers on there so that they can go through this work. And then once we rolled out the first week, we took a 1 day for intentional professional development for our teachers, which was that April 6th, that first Monday. And then we launched last week, Tuesday through Friday. And so, you know, the lessons we're learning are, I'll say this, I guided our schools and said, we really want this to be about three main principles of implementing this. The first being around support for students. And so this is a tough one. We, you know, in the whole grading and how you grade students and, you know, we just don't want students harmed from this. We know we have kids out there who have housing insecurity now as a result, and maybe didn't have it before, food insecurity. Parents have lost jobs. Parents are sick, deaths in the family. I mean, all of these things are happening within our homes. Our teachers are trying to teach while also providing childcare for their own children. So we want our kids working, but we don't want kids being lost, falling through the cracks, failing because of this. And so that's a guiding principle. Second guiding principle is about flexibility. So this is not a kid wakes up at 7:40 and starts work, and then at 2:20 they're done, and for an hour they go to math and an hour they go to English. We know there's so many families out there who may have three or four kids in the household and only one device. So flexibility might mean kids work on weekends. Some might work in the evening. And so our schools being very flexible in when kids are learning and engaging with our staff. And then finally, if possible, every attempt to over-communicate. So calling, you know, using email, using the Google platforms, but as much as possible to call and get out there. And we know we're still collecting that data from the first week, how many kids participated. But we think it's going to be in the high 80s, even to 90% of our kids are participating in NTI. So we still got a ways to go. We want it to be 100%. But I think learning around those principles, especially around student support so students aren't harmed, and flexibility in our lessons are, how do we even do that better in the first week? And so really getting everyone to get out of the paradigm of whatever we were doing on March 12th, trying to make that the same way virtually. That's just not going to work out. And instead think about, let's just support students in their learning for the next 6 to 8 weeks, get them moving forward and work hard to support our kids.
Got a question in from Facebook from William Duff asking about, do you have any thoughts on coming back to school? And he's just saying, wouldn't it be best just to keep the kids home till beginning of next school year?
Yeah, well, William, I mean, as I've answered several times in other platforms, I believe that's probably what's going to happen. You know, I think everyone, especially for our seniors' sake, would love for us to get back together. You know, having the seniors go through this breaks my heart. I mean, you know, this is one of the best times in an educational career, is the final month of a senior's journey, K through 12. And we all know that graduating from high school is almost like a rite of passage. You are moving from being a child to an adult, and it is one of the most meaningful experiences. And so I think we would all love to get back together at some point so that we could have some of those activities. I think it's probably unlikely at this point that that will happen, seeing what's happening across the country. But I think it's important to note as well that I get the question a lot that I should cancel school. I don't have the legislative authority to do that. And so there is legislation at the state level that says we must provide 1,062 hours of instruction per year. And if we go above that, our Board of Education can go down to that 1,062 threshold, but we cannot go below that. That would either take the legislature to act on that, you know, or the governor, I would assume through an executive order, could take that action. So we will wait to continue to see it. NTI continues to count as hours towards that 1,062. So if nothing happens and we stay out of school, we will stay at NTI until June 3rd, which our board will vote on that tonight at a special meeting. June 3rd would be our last day. So we will go NTI to June 3rd. Or if we're given guidance that we could go back to school, we would do that. But most likely, I think we will be in NTI for the remainder of the year.
And then let's jump forward then to August and school resumes. We're going to have to learn a lot more between now and then, even what that looks like, right? And we will have to flatten the curve. We'll have to be coming down on the other side, which, gosh, I sure hope we will by then. And then we'll start loosening restrictions on who can move about in the community. But there's a lot of pieces that go back into coming back to school. You know, you've got grandparents that might be the caregiver. They could be transporting kids to school. You've got older people that work in the schools as well. So there's going to just be, have to be a whole lot we're going to have to figure out here as a community. But one thing I think we've demonstrated to everybody, and everybody's demonstrated to themselves, is we've been very resilient. We've been very adaptable throughout all this. So just like you guys figured out how to do NTI in 3 weeks, we'll figure these things out.
Yeah.
We're going to follow the best health guidance as we can, because what we know, this virus attacks those that are the most vulnerable. And you've got some kids with some special health care needs at JCPS.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that. I mean, and I'm no expert on this, as I envision the rollout of returning to the normal world, whatever that may be, once we get through this, you know, obviously, I would see more, in my estimation, of things like soft openings. Small gatherings of people would be allowed, but not large gatherings. In JCPS, we have buildings that have more than 2,000 people in them, students and staff. And so clearly that's a large gathering. And so I think as we look at schools, and as you said, the amount of people in there that might have specific medical needs or be in high risk categories is something of a major concern for us. We have been very fortunate that in JCPS at this point, you know, we haven't seen a large number of cases, students or staff. We know there's some out there that maybe have not been diagnosed. But we've been fortunate at this point. And so we want to make sure our number one thing and is safety and health of our staff and students. And so we're gonna have to monitor that. And I mean, you know, obviously there's concerns about if we come back in the fall and there would be new sets of cases, what the response would be then. You know, and I think we are preparing ourselves to be better if that were to happen. We're talking about things, Mayor, like summer school, which, you know, we had a robust summer program last year, and we want to double it and triple it this summer. But we don't know if in July we'll be able to do that or not. Let's hope we do. But we're also preparing, what would a virtual summer school look like? How could we provide virtual services to kids in the summer for 20,000 kids? So a Chromebook and a hotspot may be much cheaper, much less expensive than actually physically bringing a kid to school. We'd like that better, bringing a kid, but we've got to start thinking of other ways to provide services to kids that may be different than anything we've ever done.
The connection between the students and the teachers has never been more important. We just got a note in here from Bink Kelly, who's a teacher, I guess, at Portland Elementary, who says, second graders have been texting me pictures and videos of their work, their NTI work, with great smiles and great enthusiasm. So it's wonderful to hear that kind of feedback.
And you remember, I think, was it last year we finished the year out at Portland Elementary? Saw the kids leave for the year. And so great school, Portland Elementary. But, you know, the great thing is, you know, we are seeing incredible, even before we started NTI. I mean, there were teachers out there that were interacting and reaching out to kids because they care about their kids. There is no doubt teaching is a calling. And it is one of, if personally, I'm not saying what jobs are more difficult. I'm saying teaching is one of the most challenging jobs that's out there. And parents that are with their kids now probably appreciate teachers more than they ever have before. And I think as a, one of the positives that comes out of any crisis is our teachers will feel a sense of, our community will appreciate nationwide teachers more than they ever have before and the service they provide. But I've just been inspired by what I see of our teachers, just reaching out, supporting our kids, posting videos, thinking innovatively of how we can better support our kids. You know, yesterday I was leaving the house, just to stop by up here at Van Hoos, and my daughter was on with her dance teacher talking. And so I had to embarrass her in front of some of her classmates on, which is a dad's job, is supposed to do that. But just incredible stuff's happening throughout this district. And I can't thank our teachers enough for that.
No, they're amazing. I work with a lot of them on the Compassionate Schools Project, and we've been closing our Lift Up Lou sessions every night with compassion and mindfulness. At 7 o'clock, we've gotten a lot of feedback on that, that people like that, that they're able to kind of chill out a little bit at night. Of course, some of your elementary students and then the Compassionate School teachers have really been showing what leadership looks like in that area. So we appreciate that.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. Fantastic program.
Doug Brent has written in on Facebook. He says, Dr. Pollio, is JCPS accepting donations of internet capable hardware?
Yeah, we are accepting donations, especially of devices. And then, you know, clearly we have to go through some process with those devices, getting them from folks into our central office, making sure that they're compatible and those type of things. You go online to the JCPS website, there's instructions on how to donate. We'll have someone contact. You know, as we go through this, it's amazing the challenge, Mayor. Every time we think, let's do something, let's mail this out to somebody. Let's, you know, we were just talking yesterday about special education services and mailing them out. But every time we want to take a step like that, it requires people gathering in some sense to do that. And so we always have to pause and think about, okay, social distancing and safety and health first, and then educational services second. And yes, those are extremely important, but safety and health number one. And so we've had to, you know, a little bit off note, you know, we've had things like people want to get into schools to get musical instruments of their children, or staff needs to get in. But we know every time we take that step, there is a health risk to doing that. Someone's opening a school, somebody, there's the potential of spread. And we're working hard to make sure that health and safety comes first. So yes, check our website out. And if that you find, to shoot me an email and I'll connect anyone to the right person to reach out for any donations anyone would like to provide for our students.
And are there ways for people to financially contribute to JCPS if they want to help you all purchase some more hardware devices?
Yes, that one of the things we are doing, once again, we gave out 20,000 of those Chromebooks to our kids. We know, you know, they're at homes right now and things happen. So, you know, we got those from schools. We made a commitment that our schools would get these back or have them replaced. And so we are looking at ways to say, you know, we'd love for families to be able to keep these Chromebooks. And so donations will really go to support that. And that link is on our website at JCPS to support in any way how we can do this long term. So we're thinking short term right now during this NTI, but we're also thinking long term. How do we make this better for our kids so that if a kid's absent from school, and we know school attendance is a major issue nationwide, how can a kid open up a laptop, have connectivity, and connect with their teachers while they're at home, possibly sick, or not being able to be at school, turn in makeup work, provide interventions for kids. A kid has a laptop and connectivity. It is a game changer.
Those that don't, it's a game changer the other way. And that's why, you know, before the virus really started hitting this part of the city, you recall we worked on three major issues. One was to set up the One Louisville COVID-19 Relief Fund because we knew people would be damaged, and we've raised over $8 million for that. The second was to create Lift Up Lou, so we had, you know, a morale building approach toward the city. And then the third was to emphasize digital inclusion and how the city could help make sure that we've got digital equity. And Grace Simroff, Metro, and David Jones, one of our great citizens, said, how can we help JCPS? So talk a little bit about their involvement and then how we got involved with the telecommunication providers and how that helped you guys get through this in any way.
Yeah, it was, it's been, you know, one of the special moments of this whole thing. And Grace Simroff, you know, jumped in right away, said, how can we help? David Jones Jr. was a big part of this. He rallied some foundations around this work. But what we really said is we can send out Chromebooks, but if a kid has a Chromebook but doesn't have Wi-Fi connectivity, then the Chromebook's just a word processor. They don't have any opportunity to interact with teachers, get that work, access the internet, videos, all of those things. The Chromebook doesn't help without connectivity. And so, you know, we really looked at what are some ways that we can increase Wi-Fi access for our students that don't have it. And working with several providers, you know, we finally were able, T-Mobile was a company that stepped up and said, we'll help you get hotspots to your kids and 3 months of unlimited data so that a family can take that Chromebook, connect to the internet where they might not have had it before, and really get that quality instruction. And so a big challenge from T-Mobile's end is getting, obviously, this is a demand all across America right now, are these hotspots. And so getting that to us, but last week we launched and we're about to mail out our first round of hotspots to kids. And we started with our special education students because those services still have to be provided even during a pandemic. And the only way we can provide those ECE services, special education services to kids, is through virtual meetings. And so if a special education student and family doesn't have a device or internet access, we can't provide those services. So we are now in the process of boxing those up, sending those out to families so we can continue to provide ECE services to our kids. And then we're just going to build it from there and continue to look for ways that we can access families and continue to get hotspots to those students who need it. So it's a game changer. I mean, imagine this. You have a kid who is sitting at home who might have a packet of papers in their hand, and it's very difficult to get those from the kid to the teacher when we're social distancing. But now this family has a Chromebook and has connectivity so that they can do what we're doing right now with the teacher. And that just makes all the difference in the world in learning. And so we're looking at, once again, this short term, but how can we do this for our huge number of kids so that they have this ongoing through their entire academic career?
Digital equity. Everybody has to have access, right? Online and with a device. It should be, it needs to be a basic human right in America right now for people to be able to participate in lifelong learning and career development as well. So thank you guys for leading that way. Barbara Sexton Smith, one of our great council people, is asking, how much does one Chromebook cost per student? And can folks choose to sponsor one or more students and be Chromebook champions?
That's a great idea, Barbara. She's always one of the best at passion, enthusiasm. And I always appreciate seeing her and her support of JCPS. So thank you, Barbara, for that. I think that's a fantastic idea. Don't quote me exactly on it. I don't have the exact cost of Chromebooks. I know it's around $200, I believe, per Chromebook, somewhere in that range. And so, you know, when we look at 20,000, you can do the math on that and see, you know, how much that is just for 20,000. But I think that's a fantastic idea. I think I'm going to take that and run with it and see, like, as we move forward long term in this, How can we get people to step up and say, I'm going to be a Chromebook champion and make sure everyone gets it? So great idea. And I love ideas. So now I get to tell my team, here's an idea, go implement it and do it. And I got a great team who does that. But thanks for that fantastic idea, Barbara.
So go to, what's your website is?
It's the JCPS website. I'm sorry, I drew a blank on the actual web address, but we'll make sure we get that out.
Okay, so it's as simple as going there. You can Google it if you don't know what it is. And
it is right there. Jefferson.kyschools.us. My apologies.
Very good. All right, go there and it'll be self-evident. And yeah, just think about that. I mean,
you're on the front page.
Right. And if you're providing a device to a family right now that does not have internet access, that Chromebook along with this internet hotspot can change that family's life. And that's something that can make everybody feel good for doing.
That's right.
Now, Marty, you're a very competitive person in a good way. You like to win. You like to see people win primarily. That's how you tally your wins in life, is how many other people are doing well. You had an early career, I guess, when you went to IU. Talk to us about that a little bit. You were a big part of the IU basketball team, and you had a real old school mentor coach there. What did you learn back then that you're applying now to this challenge with the COVID-19 virus? What is it that you did at IU?
Yeah, well, as a mayor, as I always had a dream to be a college basketball player. My dad was a college basketball coach, and I realized quickly that being in high school, I was about 5'6" and not very quick, and a marginal jump shot is not a good recipe for being a college basketball player. So instead, I said, I want to be a coach like my dad, and the next best thing is to find, I wrote letters to about 10 different coaches across America. Coaches like Dean Smith and Bobby Knight, and at that time, Eddie Sutton at the University of Kentucky and Denny Crum, and settled on going to Indiana University to learn to be a coach. And so I spent 4 years as a manager, doing everything from wiping the floor and water bottles, those things you see managers, up to, by the time I got older, breaking down videotape and things like that for the coaches to prepare for other teams. And so I learned a lot. One of the lessons that I always took from Coach Knight that was different than any other coach I saw, we're going to be good at a few things. And instead of trying to do everything and be marginal at a whole lot of things, I've never seen anyone who had such focus. We're not going to try to be complicated. We're not going to try to fool anybody. Here's what we're going to do, and we're going to be great at it. We're going to drill it and work it every day, and we're going to be clear about what we're good at. And so, I've tried to take that lesson through schools, is to communicate that. Here's what, instructionally, here is our expectations of being great. And then even into this position. Making sure we do that. And then into this specific thing, I was always amazed, the toughness Coach Knight and the staff and the program itself, that even when times were tough, everyone rallied around each other and said, let's get the job done and let's get better. And so I've always felt like that's a lesson I took. No matter how tough times are, all we got to do is work harder, rally around each other, come together, and let's get the job done. And so that's what we've tried to do during this pandemic as well. I'll say this one thing: if anything prepared me to be a superintendent and what it requires to be a superintendent, especially with, you're making decisions that people might not be happy with, spending 4 years with Coach Knight prepared me for this work. I didn't know it at the time, but it definitely did.
That's an unusual experience that you were blessed to have. So, and lots of life lessons there. How does that apply to spring sports? I mean, we had some of our winter sports not being able to conclude. We got some spring sports that are just in limbo, I guess would be the most generous way to describe it. I mean, any thoughts on that?
Well, it's one of the other of the many heartbreaking things that are happening. And you hate to compare. We have people losing their lives to things like sports, but there is no doubt for kids, you know, this is the most meaningful. This is what I call it, student belonging. And whether it's a club, whether it's class, whether it's sports, this is what it's student belonging in schools. And so whether it be the cancellation of the winter sports. And so, you know, we had a couple of teams who qualified for the Sweet 16 tournament who weren't able to go. And that's like a lifelong dream for kids and coaches and families. To the fact that spring sports had been practicing for a month, and well before that in conditioning and things like that. And then all of a sudden, they're not able to compete. So, you know, it's heartbreaking in many ways, you know, and we'll have all having to sacrifice. I'm hoping we get back and kids can get right back into it. I don't know what the outcome of that will be, but I know that, you know, we want to support our kids and especially our seniors in any way possible. And we are committed to doing as much as we can. I was talking with our communication team about doing some special things for seniors this year. And then without a doubt, finding a way, no matter when that is, to have commencement ceremonies for our seniors. Even if they have to come back from college to do it, we want to provide that opportunity for our seniors because it's something they deserve and they've earned.
Well, Dr. Pollio, you have faced so many challenges, you and your team through this, and especially our frontline workers that are out there getting it done. The amount of hope and inspiration that you all provided during all this has just been unmeasurable. When you think about the challenge that you all are facing, 100,000 students you have to educate every day, you basically turned up JCPS upside down to achieve that goal. And you'd be the first one to say, look, not everything's working perfectly, just the same thing in the city, but you've got a team that's working hard for the best intentions of our students in the community. And it's just extraordinarily inspiring. To me, it fills me up with all kind of hope for what you guys are doing. And I hope you see that. You got your heads down every day, but you're making an extraordinary difference. In the scale of the difference that you guys are making in the community is just really something. And you all are just one example, but a major example of how we get through something like this. And so while it is difficult, we all recognize that. And while it's all upending so many lives, we can just look at our neighbors. We can look at JCPS and say, look what they're doing. You know, these are the models about how we get through this as a community. And we see it in so many different ways. I'm just very proud of our city and you guys. It's really one of the anchor institutions for the city. So I want to say thank you for that. And I'd like for you to just close with a message to parents out there, maybe parents that are having difficulty with NTI, what supports are available to them, and also maybe a message for educators. But I'm giving you the final word here.
Yeah. So first of all, I want to say thank you very much, Mayor. That means a lot to us, and your support and your team's support means so much. You know, I will say this. One of the things that I've been very good at my entire career surrounding myself with great people. And so the people on my team and in this large organization have never worked harder than during this time to meet the needs of our kids. They've stepped up from central office administrators to our principals, to our teachers and all educators at schools. People are really stepping up during this time. And I think in the end, we're gonna see, you know, we feel a sense of unity in JCPS more than we ever have before, and a togetherness, and that will be another positive that will come from this. I know, and I'll say this, that it's challenging at home. You know, I'm a parent as well, and so my 15-year-old daughter, I work to drag her out of bed every morning and get her working, and she's a fantastic student, but you all of a sudden realize you're going from parent and you're being partially an educator in the house now too. And so we wanna support our parents and families. We know the challenge with that. When you haven't done that before, you know, my encouragement is number one, to reach out and contact teachers and the school. Once again, our principle of over-communicating from the school, you know, we want our schools reaching out as much as possible, but please, if you're having problems, connect with your teacher, email the teacher, call the school. You know, right now we don't have people at the school answering phones, but they can leave messages, and then someone from the school will contact the parent. Go to our website, our NTI website. We have parent training videos that can help support. And then obviously you can always call our hotline 313-HELP. Have patience with us like in many other areas right now. Lots of phone calls coming in. We do have people answering those phones, but it may be a 4 or 5 minute wait. Hang in there with us and we'll get your questions answered or get you connected with the right person to provide as much help as possible. But I appreciate all the support, Mayor, and everything you do to help JCPS.
Our citizens should know that, you know, we've got a plan together. Our staffs get together and meet once every quarter. You and I have a breakfast once a month just to talk about what are those common areas of interest where we can help each other. So, you know, while certainly the office of the mayor doesn't support the school, or the schools don't report into us, the success of JCPS and your students is critical to the success of our city. So anything we can do to help, we're going to do that.
Right.
We just really appreciate the work you all are doing. All of our teachers, I want to say thank you to them as well, and the staff and the board. Working through what's a difficult time, but as the saying goes, I think, I don't know who said it, but when the going gets tough.
Tough, get going.
That's so right. That's what it is. So we got to, you know, build up our resilience here during this tough time, lean on each other from a social distance, and we'll get through this together. And JCPS is just a wonderful example of this. So Dr. Pollio, thanks so much for joining us here today. And we'll look forward to more successes with you all.
Thank you for having me, Mayor.
Stay safe. All right. Thanks everybody for tuning in today, and we'll be back at 4 o'clock with